steps or vacuum, because if she has puts lot of force, then there is risk again that she can go into congestive heart failure if she has to push lot. So that's why second stage is shortened by the instrumental delivery. Active management of third stage of labor needs to be given. That is the oxytocin, and that has to be given 10 units intramuscular stat, and then controlled cord traction and delivery of the placenta. Sometimes if there is risk that the mother could go, then we could keep the perrectal misoprostol if needed after delivery. Methrogen is usually contraindicated. Even normal blood loss may be tolerated poorly in anemic patients. So you need to very carefully monitor the blood loss, and you need to have a blood arranged before this situation arises. And I also IV furosemide given after delivery to decrease the cardiac load. Postnatal early embolization is encouraged. Hemodynamics are continued for 3 to 6 months. Watch for signs of any sub-involution, purpura, sepsis, congestive heart failure, thromboembolism, and lactation failure. Avoid pregnancy at least 2 years, and you need to counsel about different methods of contraception which can be used depending on what the couple wants. So here are some MCQs. I think you would be able to solve them after we have had a detailed talk on anemia. So when would you say considered mother is anemic? When her hemoglobin level is below, and I would like you to answer and then recheck from your lecture. Most common cause of anemia in pregnancy in India is iron deficiency anemia. Can be diagnosed earliest by which laboratory test? Response to anemia management by oral iron therapy in pregnancy can be assessed earliest by which complication is not common in pregnancy with anemia? Now, coming up to the next type of anemia, that is the macrocytic anemia. So in the macrocytic anemia comes usually two things, folate deficiency and B12 deficiency. First, we will talk about the folate deficiency. Folate requirement increases in pregnancy as all tissues require folate for the manufacture of DNA. Normal values of folate concentration fall in pregnancy due to hematological effect of plasma expansion. Also, we need to use the folate supplementation to reduce the neural tube defects. Other causes would be the B12 deficiency, and also if there has been increased alcohol consumption by the mother during pregnancy. Now, coming up to the types, to the hemolytic anemia. These are the, there is defect in the production of the alpha or the beta chains of hemoglobin, resulting in the imbalance in the globin chains, which leads to ineffective erythropoiesis and hemolysis in the spleen or the bone marrow. Clinical manifestations and treatment depends on specific gene and number of alleles affected. Common features: increasing severity with increasing number of alleles is involved, hyperchromic macrocytic anemia, basophilic stippling, abnormal shaped red blood cells on blood film, and these are common in people of Mediterranean and Asian descent. Now, the pathophysiology of the hemolytic of the thalassemias. So, the thalassemia is a group of inherited blood disorders where the hemoglobin is abnormal as a result of mutations in the gene that code hemoglobin. They are inherited in autosomal recessive pattern. Although the thalassemia can occur worldwide, the carrier rate is particularly common in people from Southeast Asia and also affects those of Mediterranean, North African, Middle Eastern, Indian, and Asian origin. A mutation that affects the alpha chain causes alpha thalassemia, and beta thalassemia occurs as a result of mutation in the beta chains. Now, the alpha chains, they are produced by 4 genes, 2 on each chromosome 16. And these are inherited as pairs. Now, the severity of the condition depends on how many of those genes have altered. If out of 4, only 1 gene is mutated, then the women are usually asymptomatic. If women carry two mutations, alpha thalassemia trait, they may have mild anemia. Hemoglobin H disease occurs when an individual carries three mutated genes, and they will lead to chronic anemia that requires regular blood transfusions. Alpha thalassemia major occurs when all the four genes are mutated and is associated with a high incidence of intrauterine death. In the coming up to the beta genes, there are only two beta genes, one each on chromosome 11. The beta thalassemia phenotype can range from moderate to severe. Beta thalassemia major occurs when both the beta genes are affected, and affected individuals will require blood transfusions for the rest of their life. Beta thalassemia intermediate is a milder form of the condition and is non-transfusion dependent. Also, I mentioned about the fetal hemoglobin. The fetal hemoglobin, that is the hemoglobin F, there are two genes, alpha 2 and gamma 2. But then in the adult, it switches to hemoglobin A, that is the alpha 2 and the beta 2. And we talked about that. In the hemoglobin A, that is the adult hemoglobin, is 97% is hemoglobin A and 3% is hemoglobin A2. So we have been talked about alpha thalassemia, and usually fetuses develop marked hydrops and pregnancies complicated by polyhydramnios and preterm delivery. And also it is affected by severe preeclampsia, no treatment, and until diagnosis in subsequent pregnancies. Again, the beta thalassemia is due to defects in the normal production of the beta chains. And so if there is a doubt, that all pregnancies should be offered hemoglobin electrophoresis for the diagnosis of these thalassemia. So women will have low MCV, but usually it is seen that MCHC is also low is normal in cases of thalassemia. Iron and folate supplementation should be given, and their partners should be screened. If both partners have thalassemia minor, then 1 in 4 chance of that the fetus could have thalassemia major. Now we come up to the sickle cell syndromes, and that is a sickle cell disease. It is three, and then sickle cell trait, sickle cell hemoglobin C disease, that is hemoglobin SC, and other autosomal inherited disease. So these are again the different forms of hemoglobinopathies. So sickle cell disease is basically an autosomal inherited genetic where abnormal hemoglobin S contains beta globin chains with an amino acid substitution that results in its precipitating when in its reduced state. What happens then? The blood cells become sickle shaped, as have been shown in the slide before, occlude the small blood vessels. There is severe anemia, chronic hyperbilirubinemia, and predisposition to infection, vaso-occlusive complications, including the acute chest syndrome and chronic kidney disease. And so it has very high mortality. Advances in the treatment of sickle cell disease have resulted in average lifespan in the Western world extending to up to 50 years, which means many more women with conditions are now becoming pregnant. Like other medical disorders, ideal management begins with the pre-pregnancy optimization. So in the antenatal period, you are going to give education to the mother regarding her health, and also high dose folic acid supplementations, 5 mg daily, are usually recommended. And sometimes the woman might need to be given low dose aspirin. Pregnancies associated with an increased incidence of sickle cell crisis that may result in episodes of severe pain, typically affecting the bones or the chest. The acute chest syndrome may result from an initial uncomplicated crisis and is responsible for around 25% of all deaths of sickle cell disease. So this is because of the sickling. The crisis is precipitated by hypoxia, stress, infection, and hemorrhage. Mothers are also at increased risk of miscarriage, preeclampsia, fetal growth restriction, premature labor, with 3 times risk of eclampsia compared to women who do not have sickle cell disease. Also, it has been seen that there is risk of fetal growth restriction. Thromboembolic events including cerebral venous thrombosis and deep venous thrombosis are also seen. There is higher rates in sickle cell disease. So we have been talked about how would you do screening at booking, and if there is positive sickle cell disease, then again offered counseling and prenatal diagnosis also so that to see if the baby is not affected. Prevent sickle cell crisis by avoiding hypoxia, dehydration. Hemoglobin levels should be maintained above 10 grams per deciliter. Aim would be vaginal delivery with epidural anesthesia and monitoring labor, especially, and also to advise contraception. So one more thing, that sickle cell hemoglobin C disease may cause only mild degree if there is hemoglobin C disease, and it is associated with very severe crises that occur more often in pregnancy. In this condition, women are not as anemic as those with SS disease, and the severity of crisis may be underestimated. The ones who are sickle cell carriers again have a 1 into 4 risk of having a baby with sickle cell disease if the partner also has a sickle cell trait. Carriers are usually fit and well, but they are at increased risk of urinary tract infection, and they also rarely suffer from crisis. Now we talk about thrombocytopenia, that is defined when the hemoglobin level is below 115 times 10 grams per deciliter. And so there could be incidental finding, for example, on just the lab, or sometimes the woman could present some symptoms like she could have any purpura or petechiae on the skin. The causes are again incidental thrombocytopenia, or there is increased consumption of platelets, there is autoimmune thrombocytopenia, there is activated clotting mechanism. Sometimes thrombocytopenia is associated with preeclampsia, HELLP syndrome, and DIC. Platelet thrombus formation, hypersplenism, or decreased platelet production. So before I end, just wanted to give you more important things, that in pregnancy, it is very important if there has been a case of thrombocytopenia, so we need to have a liaison with the hematologist as well. First of all, we need to see what could be the causes, again from the history and examination and investigations, and then we would monitor the pregnancy to check the platelet level, and then we need to decide what time we need to deliver. Sometimes we need to arrange the platelets, transfuse platelets, and then induce the mother and deliver her. And during, if there is a case of autoimmune thrombocytopenia, then sometime we need to give steroids so that the platelets levels are being increased and the mother can be managed. Also, the steroids can be given the dose of 40 to 60 milligram prednisolone, and because they will suppress the platelet onto autoantibodies. Sometimes it need to be given about 2 to 3 weeks. If it is not effective, then intravenous immunoglobulin, IgG, has to be given in case of autoimmune thrombocytopenia. Again, vaginal delivery is usually facilitated, and usually the regional anesthesia is avoided if the platelet counts are below 80 into 10 to the power 9 per liter. Fetal blood sampling or instrumental delivery is also avoided. So this is all about anemia, and also we talked about other hematological conditions along with anemia, that was thalassemia, sickle cell disease, and thrombocytopenia. Thank you very much.